On this week's show, Elon Musk clarifies supercharger access for Tesla Model 3 owners, Volkswagen considers building its own massive battery Gigafactory, and a fix to those naughty Model X doors. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, June 3rd, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and despite the pleas from some of the Transportevolve faithful on Twitter, no, I'm not going to be doing any part of this week's show as a character I may or may not have played at a recent convention in Portland. Sorry, nope, not gonna happen. We start today's show with one of several Tesla stories this week, namely that while the Tesla Model 3 electric car might be coming to market next year with supercharger-compatible hardware as standard, it won't come with free, unlimited supercharger access as standard. While Tesla has always maintained that supercharger hardware would be standard for all Model 3 cars, it's refrained from committing on supercharger access for Model 3 customers for the past 3 months. But during Tesla's annual shareholder meeting on Tuesday this week, Tesla CEO Elon Musk confirmed that Tesla would offer Model 3 customers supercharger access as part of an optional extra add-on package. It's all part of Tesla's ploy to keep the entry-level price of Model 3 as low as possible, while also allowing those who need to use superchargers the option of paying extra to access Tesla's extensive ultra-fast DC charging network. So far, while there are a small minority of people complaining about this news, most of the folks we've talked to support the move. What about you? Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Staying with Tesla a little longer, we also heard this week that the California automaker has finally set a date of July 29 for the official opening ceremony of its massive lithium-ion manufacturing and reprocessing Gigafactory facility just north of Reno, Nevada. While some outlets are scratching their heads and asking how Tesla can hold an opening ceremony when less than 20% of its facility is currently finished, it's worth remembering that the Gigafactory is being built in stages, with the first stage almost officially complete right now. It's also worth remembering that while the official opening ceremony won't take place for another 2 months, Tesla is in fact already using the Gigafactory to carry out final assembly on its Tesla Powerpack and Powerwall static energy products, using battery cells sourced from third-party locations. What can we expect for the July 29th event? Well, if anything is to go by from the past, it'll probably live stream on the internet and involve some snippets of information about Tesla's latest and greatest electric cars. But other than that, well, we're just going to have to wait to find out. Talking of waiting, this week we learned that queuing in France at fuel-starved petrol stations during the ongoing French labour dispute, something which started more than a week ago and which has led to riots at filling stations as people clamour for the last drops of dinosaur juice to put in their tank, has caused a noticeable uptick in inquiries about electric cars. As Autoblog Green noted this week, the labour dispute, something the French are kind of known for, shut down oil refineries where the majority of French gasoline and diesel are produced, leaving hundreds of thousands of French people without a way to get to work in the morning. Jumping on the bandwagon in double quick time, Renault's marketing department ran a series of social media campaigns informing frustrated citizens that in France, we don't have a lot of oil, but we do have the Zoe, complete with a picture of the Renault Zoe EV, and of course, a way to find out more. As well as being a cute catchphrase that's caused inquiries to spike 50%, it's a throwback to the fuel crisis of 1976, where highly successful campaigns to encourage people to reduce their energy and to go to bed early, thus saving oil reserves, said, "In France, we don't have a lot of oil, but we do have ideas." Will Renault's ad campaign translate to sales? Well, it's probably a little too soon to ask, but I'm eager to find out. While Renault is busy benefiting from the French labour strike, we heard this week that Volkswagen is also kicking up plans to benefit from the surge in demand for electric cars as well. And despite having very little spare cash due to the whole Dieselgate scandal, it appears that the German automaker is readying plans to build its own multi-billion-dollar battery manufacturing facility similar to the Tesla Gigafactory. That's according to German business broadsheet Hanselblatt, which ran an exclusive story midweek suggesting that Volkswagen CEO Matthias Müller, along with the rest of the executive team, are looking to reach a total yearly production goal of 1 million electric cars per year within the next decade. And for that to happen, it's drawn up a plan that includes a multi-million euro battery facility to give it independence from firms like Panasonic, LG Chem, and Samsung. The plans will have to be put before a non-executive supervisory board first, and then, if approved, will be officially revealed at Volkswagen's annual general meeting on June 22nd. But will Volkswagen's plans really come to fruition, and will it save the troubled brand from extinction? Well, leave your mind drops in the comments below. We're off to the US next, where Ford has quietly increased the all-electric range of its 2017 Ford Fusion Energy plug-in hybrid from 20 miles to 22 miles. While it's a small incremental improvement, it's worth noting that this extra range seems to come courtesy of not a next-generation battery pack, but a few important tweaks to the powertrain control software and regenerative braking system algorithms that the midsize sedan uses. Indeed, the upcoming 2017 Ford Fusion Energy has a battery pack capable of storing just 7.6 kilowatt hours of electricity. That's the same size as the pack in last year's model. But as our friends at Green Car Reports noted this week, those few extra miles of all-electric range also translate to a fuel economy rating improvement to 42 miles per gallon, combined when operating as a hybrid, and 97 miles per gallon equivalent when operating as an electric vehicle. While hardened electric fans may poo-poo the Fusion and its limited range zero-emission capabilities, it's worth mentioning that as one of the largest volume automakers in the US, Ford does have the potential to encourage a whole lot of drivers to use less gasoline and more electricity. And every little helps, right? The Ford Fusion Energy may still have a dirty gas-guzzling engine somewhere under the hood, but the Nissan Leaf, which we note experienced particularly poor sales figures in the US during May, is as clean as the power source that generated the electricity you're putting into it, and as clean as the factory that made it in the first place. And that's something critics of electric cars are all too keen to remind us, citing increased carbon footprint of making an electric car because of the mining and refining operations that go into making the electric vehicle battery pack. Well, this week, Nissan made a major step in lowering the carbon footprint of the Nissan Leaf manufacturing process by switching on a brand new photovoltaic solar array at its UK Sunderland production facility where the Leaf is made, which, when combined with all the wind turbines already at the facility, will provide enough electricity annually to build the equivalent of just over 31,000 cars. In total, the new array, made up of 19,000 photovoltaic solar panels, will put out around 4.75 megawatts of power. Combined with the 10 wind turbines already in operation, that 11.35 megawatts of renewable energy now going to the facility accounts for around 7% of the plant's total energy requirements. And while that may sound like a small percentage, it's a massive reduction in Nissan Sunderland's overall carbon footprint. Well done, Nissan, and here's hoping to 100% renewable energy plants at some point in the near future. Staying with the Japanese automaker for a second, we also heard it make a bold promise this week, confidently predicting that, thanks to continued high sales of the Leaf and ENV200 electric vehicles in Europe, that 20% of its all-new car sales will be electric vehicles in just 4 years' time. 20 by 2020. The prediction comes from Nissan Europe EV division chief Gareth Dunsmore, who told Hybrid Cars this week that the success of Nissan's EVs in France, Norway and the UK have really helped push up Nissan's electric vehicle sales figures. And with major European cities like London, Paris and Madrid looking to make it even harder to drive in them unless you have a low emission vehicle, it's no surprise Nissan is feeling positive about its future. Based on conversations I've had with friends and family back home, it does seem that electric cars are certainly more popular now than they were even a year ago. And in thanks to continuing incentives and improved public charging awareness, we think it's going to just get bigger. Will Nissan hit its goal? Well, we'll just have to wait and see. We're back to Tesla now for the next story, but this time not the Model 3 or the Gigafactory. We're talking about the Tesla Model X, Tesla's current flagship model, which has proven something of a thorn in Tesla's side of late, thanks to questionable reliability of those massive and massively complicated Falcon Wing doors. Over the past few weeks, we've heard stories of doors failing to close and bashing other doors or objects in the process, thanks to failures in the object detection system, generally being a pain in the bum. But as Tesla CEO Elon Musk promised this week, during Tesla's annual shareholder meeting, there is hope on the horizon in the form of a software update. Admitting the coding for automatic front and Falcon Wing door operation was harder than Tesla first thought, Musk said that the new software update, due via the usual over-the-air software update system that Tesla operates, should fix the majority of issues and will be pushed to customers' cars in the coming weeks. The fix will also address a number of other quality control issues that customers have been complaining about too, so keep your eyes peeled for that update in case you happen to own a misbehaving Model X. Talking of misbehaving cars, you might remember last week that we covered an increasing number of stories involving Tesla cars, which seemed to be misbehaving while being driven in autopilot mode. At the time, we asked you to let us know if you felt drivers were to blame, and in fact, if they needed to pass some tests before being allowed to use autopilot. And based on some of the comments, most of you seemed to think that some form of training would be a sensible idea. Well, this week we heard from Andrew Ng, former Google employee and founder of its deep learning project. No stranger to autonomous vehicles himself, he took to Twitter to berate the owner of the Tesla Model S, which, as we reported last week, crashed into the back of a stationary van that was parked, saying that it was irresponsible to ship driving systems that worked only some of the time. Tesla has maintained that responsibility for the vehicle lies with the owners and that it continuously educates customers on how to use the system. But in the last week alone, we've heard of even more stories involving pileups, including several rear endings and one case where a Tesla Model S actually jumped over another car after the owner failed to pay attention. Here at Transport Evolved, we can see both sides of the argument, but we also think it's time someone steps up to the plate to ensure that whatever is going wrong gets fixed quickly, regardless of who's responsible, or it could set back the future of autonomous driving many years. And finally, while we're on the subject of setbacks, you may remember several years ago that California, working with various automaker and hydrogen fuel cell suppliers, announced a massive rollout of hydrogen filling stations across the Golden State in an attempt to accelerate the mass adoption of hydrogen fuel cell cars. The goal? To ensure that there are enough hydrogen filling stations on the roads of California by the time Toyota launched the Mirai hydrogen fuel cell sedan, its first production fuel cell car. But as you may also remember, that didn't happen, with filling stations going up far more slowly than initially had been planned. In fact, it got so bad that Toyota had to bring its own mobile filling stations to dealerships to ensure that Mirai owners could actually drive anywhere. Well, this week, First Element, one of the companies behind the filling station rollout, confidently predicted it will hit the number of filling stations it was meant to have reached in operation by the end of last year, by early 2017. That's about 18 months behind schedule. Given most automakers are now shifting towards electric and plug-in hybrid rather than hydrogen vehicles, however, we can't help wonder if these stations will actually materialize or if it's just wishful thinking. And I'm not holding my breath. And that's your lot for today. Don't forget to leave your reactions to the stories we covered in the comments below, as well as giving us a thumbs up and share if you liked it, and if you didn't, a thumbs down. And do tell us why, because otherwise we can't improve. I'll be back next week at the usual time with another episode of T.E.N. And in the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print on our website at transportevolve.com. Catch up with us on the Twitters at transportevolve, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by supporting our Patreon crowdfunding campaign over at patreon.com/transportevolved. As we've said before, we really want to grow our network and our site, and it can only happen if you help us raise the funds we need to get to that next level. And right now, that means bringing in about another $400 or so per month, so please do consider donating. As always, there are a lot of stories you didn't manage to fit into today's show, including how the Texas GOP is Tesla's new best friend, more details on those new plug-in hybrid taxis that will soon enter service in London, how charging providers are actually against more car charging stations in California, and our Reader Rides contributor Stephen Nocta fills us in on his third anniversary with the 2013 Toyota RAV4 EV electric car. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving!